Hello.
Hola.
Bonjour.
Привет.
你好。
Hello and welcome to Language with Chu. This time around, we're going to go a little bit into biology. I'm not an expert biologist by any stretch of the imagination, but if you're like me and you studied linguistics, you probably never had to do any biology course, and that's a problem, and I'll tell you why in a minute. The majority of us have a vague idea of Darwin's theory of evolution. And in linguistics, it's kind of like pretty much the most common belief. It is a belief, believe me, that things happened in evolution the way Darwin described them. So we need to question some of these things in order to understand language for its whole complexity. And I'll mention other theories in which we'll see how it applies to biology and how it applies to language. So let's have fun. I promise it's not going to be hard because I'm not an expert, and I just want to give you a global idea so that you think about language in these ways. So let's get started. You probably already know that Darwin's theory of evolution is based more or less on trees that look like this, right? Which, by the way, looks very similar to language trees when you look at them. The language, the tree of evolution was based on what linguists were doing at the time with languages, with families of languages. So it's kind of a, obviously it's very simplified in this drawing, just to refresh your mind about it. But basically, Darwin said had five main ideas or principles to his theory of evolution. First of all, evolution itself, meaning that species come and go through time and they change within their existence. Within generations, sometimes it could take many, many, many generations to change, but they change and they multiply and they, at some point, they diversify into two species. And that has occurred over and over and over since the Big Bang. So started from nothing practically, a bunch of proteins got together, and then everything came to be, right? That's the theory. The idea of common descent is that ultimately everything comes, every single living organism comes from a common ancestor, or sometimes several, depending on how they mixed along the line of evolution. Gradualism. It's one of the main important characteristics of Darwin's theory, and that is that changes happen in very small incremental stages. One mutation, one random mutation. And it's not possible, according to Darwin, for a species to kind of sprout out of nowhere. It has to be a very slow and gradual evolution. And finally, natural selection is this invisible force. Some people call it the blind watchmaker, because when you see a watch, you notice that it's complex and that it has a purpose and a mechanism. But somehow a blind watchmaker decides what each part is going to do and how to put them all together. Well, according to natural selection, would be this force that selects the members of a certain species that are more apt to survive and to reproduce. That's basically Darwin's theory of evolution, and I hope to show you that it's not only not possible, but it's actually a fairy tale. The main problem with this is that there are many, many missing links. One of the most important ones, the transition between from primates to men. And it's still, nowadays, a dogma. He wrote in 1861 the first time, and the origin of the species. And still today, he's quoted as the truth, basically. But in reality, it's kind of a dogma, and we'll see why in a minute. So basically, that's it, just to refresh your mind about Darwin. But let's move on to language now, just for a minute. So what did he say about language? In 1871, he wrote a second book, The Descent of Man, after 10 years or so from his first theory. And supposedly, he was trying to kind of make it tie to explaining how human beings came to be. But it was quite a stretch. And, well, obviously he said that we came from primates, right? So, if you look at his, particularly as his theory of how language came to be, he had to say something because people were asking him at the time, well, how about language? How about, you know, we're so different from apes that you have to explain how such a change could have occurred, right? Well, this is his idea. First of all, there was some kind of smart ape that one day was born and with a lot more intelligent and with more complex mental ability. So, for example, maybe abstraction or the capacity to hold thoughts in his mind for a while, etc. And he had, so this was this genius primate, ancestor, let's say, right? That's the first stage. The second stage was that human being, primates, or the ancestor of the human being, started using sounds and singing for courting, for territoriality, to express some emotions. Basically, it was to attract a mate. And natural selection made it so that the ones that were most able to sing and attract a partner survived longer and continued evolving. And the stage number three from that is that they started adding meaning to those songs that they were singing, that nonsensical, or maybe not nonsensical, but at least purely emotional, instinctive singing started acquiring meaning. First, it was by imitating sounds in nature, imitating sounds in animals, kind of like onomatopoeia, you know, like splash. That sounds kind of what it like what it does. That was the first stage, and then little by little, people decided to separate that string of sounds into words and syntax and all the complex grammar that we have today. That's basically Darwin's theory about language. And many, many linguists quote his theory as it being completely rational and possible, except that nobody has found, we don't have any records of language as it was 150,000 years ago, so it's all pure guesses, right? Well, there are some alternatives. For example, some linguists, I believe it's, for example, Corbalis, he says that evolution would have been even more gradual. There wouldn't have been a gradual evolution, a sudden smart ape, but a gradual evolution in humanity that led to having complex thoughts, abstraction, etc. But we still have that missing link that nobody can explain. And nobody explains how it could have been so gradual. And I'll get to that in a minute. Some things that you could theorize were gradual happened to be necessary all at once. So you couldn't start with one single mutation or one single change if you want to achieve a specific result. But I'll get to that later. Second, for the idea that it was sexually selected, there's other papers, other theories about how it could have been not so much for reproduction, but because human beings started needing to teach their young very early on, and the human babies are actually they're not independent like other babies in nature and for animals. They get independent very quickly, while human babies need a lot of care and attention for the first years of their lives. So maybe people figured out that they needed to teach their young, and what better way to teach their young than through language, and then they started developing, etc. Another problem with that is that language, if it was for mating, usually think of a peacock, you know, the peacock, the male peacock has its tail, and there's the female and the male usually have different traits, especially when it comes to singing or dancing and things like that in birds. But in our case, males and females have the same language capacity. They speak just as well. So that throws the idea away, because it doesn't really add much. Many aspects of language don't add much to our reproductive interests. There's no reason for it to have evolved if it was just for reproduction or survival. We'll come to that. We'll go into that in more detail later as well. And then finally, for the idea that from strings of words came meaning, there's also several other theories. One was by Otto Jespersen, I think, a famous linguist, and he said that actually it all started, instead of first a word, a song, and imitating a sound of an animal or something, it all started as the full song, and then people attributed meaning to the chunks of that string of sounds. So Darwin would say, no, first we started with grunts and small chunks, small songs, while other people would think, okay, started as a whole song, and then they attributed meaning. But it still doesn't explain anything, if you ask me, because why did the songs came about? Why and who decided to split them into meaning separately, nouns and verbs and all the complexity of grammars nowadays? No, and on top of that, the complexity of grammars, whether you're talking Darwin or any other theory, is so vast and so intricate that it's very difficult to imagine how it came to be if you follow this progression. So that's it for what Darwin has to say about biology and what Darwin has to say about language. The problem here is that, okay, we have to define some terms before we move on to more biology. There's a confusion between language evolution, which is basically historical linguistics, how each language evolved. French from Old French, English from Old English, from Germanic, blah, blah, blah. That's language evolution. But there's also evolution of language, and those terms are kind of interchangeable. I'll probably mess up too and say language evolution. It doesn't matter, just as long as you know that you have to separate it, because it's going to be a lot more complex on this second little bubble that I've got here. That's about the species, phylogenetic, so the species. And there's many questions that linguists ask or don't, actually, many times. One is it God or is it Darwin? As in, and I don't mean, well, some people would mean God, as in the Christian God or the Buddhist, you know, religion or whatever. Is there a supreme force that created language all in a package as it is? Or was it a gradual progression, like Darwin said? That's question number one. Question number two was, is there a monogenesis or polygenesis? Meaning, was there one language in the beginning, this mother tongue that every linguist is looking for, that would have been there at the beginning and only that language? Or did human beings spoke many languages and created many languages even from the very beginning, which would give you different families of language and different reasons for why languages are in the end quite similar, even though they may have sprouted from different places. So that's another question that we'll explore. Again, was it gradual or abrupt? This is more in terms of language per se. Did it start with musical sounds, with grunts, etc., gestures, or was it created as we speak today, more or less, obviously with the minor differences? But that's not all. There's also more questions. There's a question of whether we have a language organ. That's a term used by Chomsky mainly, Noam Chomsky, the most famous linguist nowadays. And for years, for now 60 years, they've been trying to look for something in the brain that would explain language. And supposedly it's universal, and supposedly we all have it, and one day we'll discover it in the genes. Except that so far they haven't, and the few genes they have discovered are problematic. I'll talk about that in the future. But anyway, that's a legitimate question, and it's a question that goes around in linguistic circles a lot. Then there's how language related to thought in terms of evolution. Did we start thinking first? Did we start speaking and thinking? Did we have language only because we were able to have abstract thought, or not, etc., etc.? There's lots of questions there. In relationship to communication, is one of the main functions of language to communicate or to think? How much the motivation to communicate made us have language? Also, again, lots of questions within that little group. And then, is it nature or nurture? Meaning, are we born with all our language capacity, like Chomsky would say? Or is the cultural aspect, the us learning when we're children, more important? There's two camps there, and I think it's quite a little bit of the one and quite a little bit of the other one, actually. But we'll mention that later, and all of that ties up with how we acquire language as children. And is it important? For some linguists, it's not important. You basically have it. Except for a period where if it's not stimulated, you'll never learn it. But basically, that's it. Otherwise, you culture and teaching and parents and all that, for them, is not so important. So that those are the main questions, and that just covers the ideas behind language evolution and the evolution of the language capacity. As you can see, just from this diagram, Darwin kind of falls short, because there's no writing about you know, many of these questions in Darwin. In fact, it was very very vague at the time. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to explore all these questions in the diagram, going from biology to linguistics, back and forth, and see if we can come up with some possible responses. Thanks for watching. See you next time.